Ashan's the sun. And in Ashan's the sun because the sun is going to be the light. Okay? He's going to be the main thing up there. Okay? And we're going to be able to celebrate it. So listen, you know, we're just in practice time right now. Y'all need to crank it up. Y'all need to walk through it. Y'all need to be celebrating Jesus all the time, because once we get up there, it's going to be, we're going to be with him. Okay? When we go home, we're going to be with him. We're going to see him as he is. Oh my goodness, with the flames as a fire and the feet as a burned or polished brass and so forth. And he's going to be coming in on a white horse. Now, we talked about a white horse in Revelation Wednesday night. But, you know, when the Antichrist comes in, he comes in on a white horse. He has one little old puny crown. He's got a bow. He don't even have a sword. He's got a bow, okay? He's a faker all the way and everything. Then you turn over to chapter 19 and you read about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And when he comes in, oh, he's on a horse and his eyes are burning like fire. And he's in white raiment. And then down the side of his thigh is written King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he don't have a puny little bow with no arrows. He's got a sword in his hand. Okay, and he comes in, and he is really coming in to do some stuff. Okay, and that's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he's crowned with many crowns, it says. Okay, and he's given power, and that puny old Antichrist, he's just a faker. He really doesn't have a lot of power. And the comparison, you read over to chapter 5 of the Antichrist, turn over to chapter 19. I think verse 11, and you start reading about the King of Kings, and you compare those two pictures of the real Jesus Christ versus the Antichrist, and what a faker, and how impotent he is, and how small and insignificant he is compared to the King of Kings, okay, and so forth. And that's just, the Bible says it, so it's got to be true.
Right.
Okay? There's no mistake in that word. And when it describes those things, we need to take notice. We serve a mighty King. If you turn in your Bibles, we're going to read in chapter 4 of the book of John. John chapter 4, we're going to begin at verse 4, and we're going to read. There's a story here, and even though this is a familiar story to many people, I know God's going to share something out of this that's new. And so keep your minds open and your heart open as God opens up his word to you, and let the Holy Spirit work. Chapter 4, verse 4. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Remember, we just studied Genesis, and over chapter 33, Jacob gave his son Joseph a piece of land. This is near there. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. Now the sixth hour is noon. That's the middle of the day. So it's hot. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. They were going to buy food. Verse 9. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. You see, the Samaritans were half-breeds, okay? And the Jews didn't like them. In fact, they'd go around the city and everything. Verse 10, Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. If you only knew the gift of God, if you knew who it was that you're talking to, you'd be asking me to drink, and I'd give you living water. Verse 11, the woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with. He didn't have a jug. He didn't have a container. And the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Where are you going to get that stuff? Verse 12, art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? How can you get water out of a well? Are you better than Jacob who dug this thing? Verse 13, and Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Jesus said unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. And the woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and the man that you're living with right now isn't your husband. Verse 19, the woman saith unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. She knew there was something special about the man she was talking to. Verse 20, our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship, you know not what. You don't even know what you're worshiping. We know what we worship, for the salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman saith unto him, I know the Messiah is come, the Messiah, which is called Christ, God with us, the anointed one. And when he's come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speaketh unto thee am he. I'm the one. I'm the Messiah. Father, we thank you for the reading of your word. Lord, I ask you to take and stir in the hearts of our people. Lord, put in my heart the message that you want delivered. Lord, open their hearts that they'll receive what you want them to have. Let it line up with your word. Let it not contradict a word, a piece of your word. Your word is holy. It's without error, Lord. Lord, it doesn't contradict itself. Lord, it's inspired by you. So, Lord God, we just ask you to bless us during this time. Take this text, apply it to our lives, Lord. Teach us what you will about it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Brennan Manning tells a story in the book Lion and Lamb of a recent convert to Jesus who was approached by an unbelieving friend. His friend's first statement was, so you've been converted to Christ? He said, yes. Oh, well, then you must know a great deal about Jesus. Tell me, what country was he born in? His friend said, I don't know what country he's born in. What was his age when he died? His friend says, I don't know. How many sermons did he preach? His friend said, I don't know that. I don't know that information. Well, you certainly know very little for a man who claims to be converted to Christ. His friend said, you know, you're right. I'm ashamed that I know very little about him. But what I know is this, is 3 years ago I was a drunk. I was in debt. My family was falling into pieces. They dreaded the sight of me. They didn't want me to come home. But now I have quit drinking. I am out of debt. Our home is happy. And my children and my wife look forward to me coming home each evening. Jesus did this for me.
Amen. Yeah.
I know this about Christ.
Yes.
You can have scripture memorized. You can have the New Testament. You can just quote book after book if you want to. You may have all that knowledge in here. But unless you know Jesus in here, you don't have anything.
Amen.
A lot of us know where Jesus was born. We know what age it was he died. We know something about some of his sermons and so forth. But that none of that's necessary to know Jesus. But the things he can do for you, the changes he can wrought in your life, the establishment of steadfastness and peace and joy and long-suffering and gentleness and goodness and faithfulness and meekness and temperance, those fruits of the Spirit that he can have you walking in every day, that'll order your life, that'll straighten out your family. Jesus is the answer.
Yeah.
It's not the knowledge. It's Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Warren Webster was a missionary to Pakistan for 15 years. And when he addressed the National Missionary Convention several years back, he said, "If I had my life to live all over again, I would live it to change the lives of people. Because you haven't changed anything until you've changed the lives of people." I can go into the tea room downtown and I can sit down and buy me a lunch and I can be pleasant to the people. I can give them a tip. I can get up and leave and all the people in that room can remain unchanged. I can go over to a barber shop and sit down and visit and maybe even have my hair cut. And when I leave a group of people unchanged. I can go in and meet a group of men and sit down and visit with them, find out what's going on with the football team and something about the booster club and what they're cooking on Friday nights at the games. And when I leave, I can leave everybody unchanged, exactly the way they were whenever I walked into the room. But Jesus is calling us to go into people's lives and touch them in a way that when they walk away, they're changed. They're affected. Something's been moved in their lives. Jesus gave that example at the woman at the well. He was there in the middle of the day. Now that Samaritan woman was there in the middle of the day because she had made some decisions in her life that weren't right, socially unacceptable. And so she went so that she wouldn't be scoffed at, where there wouldn't be a crowd, and that was in the heat of the day. But I want you to look there at verse 4. And he must needs go through Samaria. His disciples didn't want to go there. Jewish people didn't want to travel there. But the Bible says he must needs go through Samaria. You see, the first thing I want to point out to you tonight is that Jesus will do the inconvenient and the socially unacceptable to meet your need, to cross paths with you. A lot of people sit down and they think, "Lord don't want to do anything for me." Oh, no, 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 he does. He loves you so much. "Oh, I'm not worthy." Yes, you are, because you're worth it. Jesus must needs come and cross your path. There's a divine appointment. There was an album many years ago named Hallelujah, a praise gathering for believers. And the album, as it starts out, a narrator starts with these words. Well down through history, changing lives has been his business. He's changed the rich. He's changed the poor. He's changed the high and the mighty. He's changed the meek. He's changed my life. And maybe he's changed yours. But if he hasn't, this can happen to you right now. Today. And then a song begins after the narration. Something beautiful. Something good. All my confusion, he understood. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife. But he made something beautiful of my life. Amen. Jesus has a divine appointment for you. It's not that you can offer him anything. Most of us have jumbled our lives up in such a mess that our friends don't want us. Maybe our parents turned their back. Maybe they didn't. But when you look at it, we just jumbled things up to the point that we ourselves sometimes don't want our life. But Jesus makes something beautiful of life. That's the message of the church. It's called to offer this message to the world. It's our mission statement. It's not optional, folks. It's essential. It's what makes ministry the most rewarding job in the world. Jesus still offers hope to lives that are hopeless and messes. In John's gospel, we find the story of a life that's been hopelessly messed up. It's not the story of a kid that made a bad decision or two. It's the story of a woman who has a whole lifetime of bad decisions. She's continually looked for love and security in relationships, but instead she found emptiness and loneliness. It's the story of a woman who in her private moments feels overwhelmed with pain because she's never imagined her life reaching that place of desperation. Hardness has crept in to cover the shame and the hurt. She's pulled herself back. She doesn't go with the other women down to draw water. She comes in the heat of the day to avoid them. There's a hardness about her life. Some of it because of the way people have treated her. Some of it because she realized what she's done is wrong. She doesn't trust people because she can't afford to anymore. She tries to ignore the whispers and the looks of judgment in town. But on many nights, her pillow is probably soaked with the tears because she believes no one cares or ever will. Is there any hope for her life to be any different? There is when God sets a divine appointment with her. Our text began, now Jesus had to go to Samaria. Really? He had to go through Samaria? Most Jews didn't. They went around Samaria, you see. Avoided it like the plague. The Samaritans were half-breeds, hated by the Jews, at least as much as the Israelites and the Palestinians hate each other today. Getting Samaritan dirt on your feet was like walking through a pig manure to the Jews. They didn't want to go there. So why did Jesus have to go through Samaria? Because there was a divine appointment to keep. An appointment that will show the importance of people no one else has value for. Jesus will go through a Samaria for you too. Mike Iaconelli in Messy Spirituality writes, her life was parched, wilted, and dry, talking about the woman at the well. She had 5 marriages and divorces. Each of these relationships began with hope. This one's the one for me, she probably thought. Next one, he'll give me some security. He'll give me value to my life. And one by one, that hope, it vanished. One might have left her for another woman. Another man might have just got tired of all the fighting. Maybe one abused her, and she ran for her life. Even though the excuses might have been different, the results were the same. Loneliness, failure, and pain. Doesn't matter what puts her in that situation. That was her situation. The Bible says that he must needs go through Samaria. All of her situations drove her to move in with the 6th guy without even making it legal. I mean, at that point, who really cared, right? I mean, she'd done so much that just repeating it again didn't really matter. Doing it again didn't mean a whole lot. Who didn't really care? Who cared? Jesus cared. Who cares about you? Jesus cares about you. I don't think anybody in this room can sit down and tell me that you've been married 5 different times and living with somebody else or messed up your life to the extent this woman has. And she was in needlessness. She was in such a mess. This now she was just living with a man that she wasn't even married to, wasn't even going through trying to make it legal. Okay? She was in a mess. She didn't think anybody cared, but oh, at the noonday in the heat of the sun, when she was carrying that big old heavy water vessel, trying to avoid all the other women in town, trying to avoid the stares, trying to avoid the talk. It was a divine appointment when she got there at old Jacob's well, who was sitting on it, Jesus. Jesus was early for the appointment. See, Jesus is early for your appointment today. He's not just on time. He's early for an appointment that maybe you don't even know you've got. But God has sat down in the appointment book of heaven and written out some things. And Jesus is there. Jesus cares. Jesus is early. It's noon. It's hot. Jesus is at the well alone because all the disciples have gone for food, see? And I think the God of the universe, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, on his appointment book, probably had a little note. Send the disciples away. Because you see, if there was a crowd of men standing there with some of the other followers of Jesus that normally went around with him, she probably would have never walked down the road to come to the well to be at the appointment. Jesus is God enough to handle what you got all by himself. He don't need his disciples. He don't need other people around. Jesus can meet your need with nobody else. In fact, he may just clear his appointment book for you. You're that important to him. Jesus will sit down. A divine appointment has begun. She's sitting there. She walks up. God's got an appointment. If you're a follower of Christ, you've got to live out 1 Peter 3:15 where it says, "But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give and give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and goodness." You see, when people start talking to you about things, then you need to have an answer ready for them that you can take. And in gentleness and love, you can sit down and share what Jesus has done for you. This woman is on her divine appointment, you see. The only way that you can live out what 1 Peter says is to have that answer because you have Christ in your heart, and to give a reason of hope to other people. If you're taking notes, you can write this down. Treat people with value. You can go up to the stinkiest individual. You can go up to that man up in Atlanta that I met. He was walking around. He was a drunk. He reeked to the point that your eyes would water. He had so much urine and smell on him. He drank. He was a drunk. He was an alcoholic. He was a street person. He lived in a homeless shelter. He came by to get a little cup of soup and stuff. And the soup there is 1,200 to 1,900 people every day walking in that place. Okay? And they don't have the resources they need. They need some help. And the soup was watered down chicken broth with a little bit of rice and mixed vegetables dumped in it, and one chicken, and probably in a pot that was that tall, all shredded up and dumped in. Those pots were huge. And they'd come by and they'd dip a ladle and stir it around a little bit and pull it out and dump it into a styrofoam cup and give it. And that was the meal for the day. And I saw this man walking around. He had a walker. He had a flag on it. His beard was down to here. It was dirty. And as he approached, I'm not exaggerating, my eyes would water from the smell of urine on him. He didn't even bother to take his britches down to go to the bathroom. He just wet himself. My first response when I saw him was to back up a little bit and walk away. But there was a divine appointment one day. Where I was able to sit down, and for some reason I just said, Jesus loves you, and he stopped. And we got to talk. And when he was a little boy, his face started smiling a little bit, and his eyes twinkled a little bit as he told me he used to go to church as a little boy. And he liked going. But through decisions he made through life, he started losing things, and he lost his family relationships and everything. And he said, how can Jesus love me? And he's standing there with a walker, and he used the walker to hang bags on. He didn't need the walker. It was a way to keep all his stuff together. And he said, I'm a drunk. I don't take care of myself. I'm of no value at all. I said, but Jesus died for you. You've got to have some value. You understand that the God of the universe came down as a baby and lived a few years and then died on a cross for you, sacrifice. He loves you so much. And after he was killed on that cross, 3 days later, he rose again. Now he's at the right hand of the Father, and he's calling out your name. He knows you. He knows your situation. He said, look at me. There's nobody who wants me. I said, Jesus does. After a few minutes, that old boy asked God to forgive him for all the stuff he'd done and all the garbage. Asked Jesus into his heart. A few days later, I was back up there at Task Force for the Homeless. And I was doing some computer work for him and helping him out with some things. And I saw this man walking across. I didn't recognize him. He'd gone into the clothing closet and got some clothes from the place and changed them on. He'd gone upstairs and took a shower. He shaved himself. He went out and got a haircut where they could get haircuts and all that stuff. I did not recognize the man. And he walked up to me as I was walking through this big congregation of people heading across to the computer area. And he walked up and he said, hey, how you doing? And I said, hey. And then it dawned on him, I didn't know who he was. Something beautiful came into his life. Oh, he didn't have nothing to offer. He was a mess. But Jesus wanted him. He had an appointment with God Almighty. And he accepted what God was calling. I want you. And he put God as a priority in his life. He asked Jesus into his heart. It changed him. Was he homeless? Yeah. Did he get extra food? No. But he started walking with the value God had placed on him. And yeah, he changed the way he dressed, shaved his face, he washed himself up. It wasn't what changed his looks that impressed me. It was how he was changed inside. He wasn't pushing a bunch of junk around on a walker. He was walking with his head up. He knew he was loved. He knew he was redeemed. He knew he was bought. He knew he was paid for. He was a child of the King. He started understanding and walking with that in his life. Oh, he was still homeless. Yeah, he still got that old watered down chicken broth. Yeah, he still didn't have any extra clothes. He started walking as a child of the King because Jesus had a divine appointment for him one day. This woman at the well, there was a divine appointment. There's a divine appointment with you. Jesus, he doesn't want to be one of your priorities. He wants to be your priority. He doesn't want to just be part of your life. He wants to be Lord of your life. He wants to give you his inheritance. The Bible says that we're heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. We're heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Jesus came to make you an heir and a joint heir with him. He has all the power and all the riches and glory. has been given to him, and we can participate in that. Oh, now I'm not telling you you're going to get rich here on this earth. I'm not telling you you're going to have any more influence than you had before, but the Holy Ghost can start working through you and changing people's lives, and that'll change your life. Until you get up and start affecting other people, you haven't changed a thing. You've gone in the barbershop, you got your hair cut, and you left everybody the same way they were before you walked in. You go into the huddle house, and you sit, and you can visit and have a good time. But you have the ability to get up without changing anybody's life if you want to. But when Jesus comes in on that divine appointment, you have the opportunity and you have the ability to change somebody's life. I have a question. If we never engage with messed up people, how are we to allow God to talk through us to them? If we never interact with messed up people, if we avoid them, what opportunity do we have to see God to talk through us and change them? I hope some of y'all go out tomorrow and y'all try to find messed up people. No, I hope that when you have the opportunity and you see somebody that's in need, maybe the world has no value of them, they can't use them anymore, and push them to the side, that you realize that's what Jesus was doing. Jesus went to people like that, and Jesus had an appointment with them, and through you, Jesus can have an appointment with those people and change their lives. We can change this city. You go downtown and you walk around. When you go out the other side of the town, are you leaving it the way you found it? Or when you walk by, is there something changed in that town? You have the ability to change people's lives. Lost people are thirsting for living water. Jesus tells her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asked you for a drink, you would ask him, and he would have given you living water. You see, lost people want living water. Lost people don't need philosophy. Lost people don't need entertainment. Lost children, they don't need football games. Lost children, they don't need soccer games. Lost children, they don't need entertainment. They don't need Xboxes. They don't need the PS4s anymore. They don't need movies. They don't need activities. They need Jesus. Sitting and listening to some families, it concerns me when children speak up and tell the parents, I'm going to this church, or I'm going to go do this, or I'm going to go here, and I'm going to go this, and I'm that, and the children are running the homes. Mamas and daddies are supposed to be running the homes. Daddies are supposed to be leading them. Mamas are supposed to be working in that area. The kids don't run the home. That's not God's way. Now, you might get upset at me and say, well, preacher, you're meddling now. That's okay. It's based on God's word. Right. You're supposed to be leading your children, teaching them the way they're supposed to go. And let me tell you what, I don't care how good a football player they are, they're probably not going to make them pros. They're probably not going to make $1 million. Yes, there's some that will. And I pray and I hope that you're blessed with your children like that. But the fact is they're not going to remember you. I was a good football player in high school. Jackie may not admit it, but I was pretty good. Okay? And a few years after I graduated from high school, we had a homecoming at Morrill High School, and that homecoming game, and I got my Letterman's jacket on, and I went over there to that place, and I walked, and you know what? Nobody even knew my name. Nobody knew who I was. It doesn't matter how good I thought I was or how good I was in reality. I think I was reasonable. But nobody knew me. They were looking at those guys screaming on the field. And we sit down and we run our kids around football and soccer and every other kind of entertainment. Things that aren't going to bring them into eternity. And when they get through with those things, they're not changed. I know football players, high school football players, that when they get out and they go to college, they can't make a team. And it dawns on them, I'm not that good. In high school, they thought they were something. They had a Letterman's jacket and everything. Then they go to college and they couldn't even walk on that field those guys were playing on. Other people and situations, disillusionment, the world don't need you, they're not picking you up, they're not bragging on you anymore, and they slowly start disintegrating into a mass. And some of them make bad choices. We got the ability to change their lives. With Jesus Christ, we can change their lives. They can walk like kings because of Jesus. They can walk with their heads up because of Jesus. Don't make them a better football player, not a better track star. They're no better at soccer, but they can walk like the heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ with their head up and realize their value is eternal and not something temporal like a football game. Jesus has a divine appointment. You see, lost people, they need that living water. They don't need being pumped up. They don't need to be catered to. They don't need to be entertained. They need Jesus. They need living water so that when you lay your hands on somebody and you pray, God starts moving. When you start calling down heaven, they know, hey, look, His voice is going beyond the ceiling. Something really is happening. God is going to listen to these people. We need to be the kind of people that can bring change in people's lives. But if you never reach out, put your hands on anybody, lay hands on them, pray the prayer of faith, what's God got to work with? What do they got as a testimony? How are you supposed to affect them? Okay? What if you lay your hands on 15 people and all of them pass on? They didn't get healed. You're not responsible for what God does. You're responsible for being one of them. And that's not being successful. It's being faithful. The devil whispered in our ears, what if you fail? No, I'm not supposed to succeed. He does that. You see, if I succeeded, then somebody sit down and say, what kind of power is in that hand, preacher? I can't even clap good sometimes, it hurts. This is the most feeble hand you'd ever want to have on you. It can't do anything. It's God. I have no power. I have no magic. I just know Jesus. I'm not supposed to succeed. I'm supposed to be faithful. You see, lost people, they've got a God-shaped hole in their life. And they take that God-shaped hole. That's their need. They need that filled. It's shaped like God. Now, I'm not going to draw you a picture. But there's a shape, God-shaped hole in their life. And they're trying to put entertainment in it. Well, it's not shaped right. It's not going to fill it. Oh, it might fill the round part, but it doesn't fill this part coming out here to the side. It's still a gap. It doesn't fit. Oh, they might fill it with friendships and activity or drugs and alcohol. They might fill it with all these different things, but it's not going to fit because, you see, the hole they got in their life is shaped like God. It's a God-shaped hole, and they're trying to fill it with a puzzle piece that don't fit. Oh, it might dull their senses a little bit. It might put a smile on their face. It might take their problems where they can't think well enough about it so they're not aware for a while. But the problems are still there. The weight's still there. The hole is still there. It's not filled. I'm not trying to tell you to partially fill something. I want you to completely fill. I want you to get, and there's only one thing, only one puzzle piece that's going to fit the hole in your life, and that's Jesus.
Right.
Oh, you might fill the square part, and you might kind of fill the round part. And if you find the square part small enough, it'll fit where the round hole is. But it's got gaps. I'm talking about being completely filled, taken care of. Have that God-shaped hole in your life filled. As a disciple, as a believer, you fill it by being obedient. You fill it by being faithful to Him. If you've never had Jesus in your life, that's your problem. You've got a God-shaped hole that you've been cramming other stuff in. I've never met anybody that didn't have Jesus that wasn't trying to cram something in it, filling it. Oh, they know there's a hole. There's a need. Oh, I need friends. I need happiness. I need to drink. I need to smoke some. I need to do this. I need to take that. I need to do this. I got to be entertained. I got to go till you go crazy. Trying to fill that hole. Well, it's a God-shaped hole, and there's only one piece that's going to fit it, and that's God. That's Jesus Christ. So if you don't have Jesus Christ in your life, You're stuffing the wrong thing in your God-shaped hole. That's the frustration. That's the emptiness that you have. Jesus will tell you there's something better. The woman at the well saw it, and she said, she realized this man was different. I perceive that you're a prophet, she said. And then he started talking. Go call your husband and bring him back. Because she was asking for this living water, right? And she said, I don't have a husband. And he said, you answered right, because you've had five husbands, and the man that you're living with right now, you're not married to. And I perceive you're a prophet, man. Something different about you. We need to be different. Okay? And I'm not talking about spooky stuff. I'm just talking about full of God, to the point that we God gives us some discernment about some things. First thing she did, she tried to misdirect and talk about where they're supposed to worship, on the mountain or in Jerusalem. Okay? And when you start talking about the lost people and stuff, oh, they'll tell you about worship. I went to this church and they behaved this way, and I went over here and look what they did. This preacher running around, the deacon's acting like this and all this kind of, they'll talk to you about worship. They'll talk to you about church stuff. The wrong things. And Jesus sat down and said, you don't even know what you're worshiping. And these people, just like that, they don't know what they're worshiping. They're observing some things and trying to confuse the discussion. And Jesus brought it right back on to it. And if you read that, in verse 22, he says, you worship, you know not what. We know what we worship, for the salvation is for the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship Him. God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. Got to do the things that God wants you to do. It's not entertainment. It's not speaking. It's not singing. It's not the production we can put together up here on a platform to entertain you. It's whether or not you're wanting to come in the holy presence of the sovereign God and be changed. First of all, fill up your God hole, your God-shaped hole. Fill it up. Get Jesus. Second, with your God-shaped hole filled up, you go sharing it with other people. Because as the woman at Samaria was told by Jesus Christ Himself, you don't even know what you're worshiping. You see, we got people coming to church, but yet they're not worshiping. They're coming in. It starts at a certain time. We sing a certain number of songs. We have our announcements at a certain spot. We take up our offer. Those are activities. Those are just actions. But you've got to come in the presence of a holy and a majestic and a sovereign God. You've got to acknowledge Him. And you've got to pray on Him. And you go, but I can't sing. Well, you can make some kind of joyful noise. And I can't clap. Well, a whole lot of white folk can't clap. But we can make a noise and have fun while we do it. Praise God, our young people can clap on time. And as we exercise those things and we praise God and we enter into worship, and we're not just doing things, but we're actually opening up. At the beginning of the service, I know what it is. Sometimes your mind's strong on something and you're singing the song, but yet it's not, you're not in praise and worship. You're just going through what you're supposed to do. And that's good. That's good. Because then the next step is all of a sudden you start becoming aware and focused on that God. And you're straining to see His face. And you want to see Jesus. And you want to follow Him. And it becomes worship, and it's not words. It becomes worship, and it starts meaning something to you. And lo and behold, before long, then you go into the time when Jesus starts touching you, and slowly, like melting ice maybe, it starts changing. Jesus comes in on that divine appointment with you. Oh, I've been saved for 40 years, preacher, but he can still have that divine appointment and meet that need right now. Maybe you're worried about your children or your grandchildren. He can meet that need. There's a divine appointment. Oh, and he's going to show up early. In fact, he'll be in this place before you walk in. So if you'll open up your heart to him, the needs he'll meet, the comfort, the peace that he can give, the satisfaction, that you can walk as a child of the King. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior tonight, while the music is playing, I ask you to come down, ask God to forgive you. Pray that Jesus become your Lord and your Savior. Okay? And follow him the rest of your life. Fill your God hole. Once you fill your God hole, your walk will start changing. Jesus talked to Nicodemus, say, about these things of the Spirit. This woman said, was talked to, and Jesus said, but those that worship God's got to worship in spirit and in truth. And that's the kind of people that God's looking for. God's not looking for talented people. God's not looking for smart people. Oh, he's blessed you with certain things, with talents and knowledge and the ability to think and all these things. And I'm not telling you to stop thinking. I'm telling you that that doesn't impress him. He gave it to you. It's the relationship. He desires those people that will worship him in spirit and in truth. That's what in verse 21-22 is telling you. He's looking for people that will worship him in spirit and truth. Not just read the words, not just show up for a meeting, not just come and go. The world sees us doing those things. Why? That's not living water, that's dry stuff. But when we come into his presence and we acknowledge him and our praise and our worship and our freedom starts coming out, because I don't care. I don't care what I sound like. I'm going to praise God. I don't care who's looking at me. I'm going to raise my hands if I feel like that. I'm going to sit down and cry because I am interacting with a holy and majestic God, and I'm not worthy. He just said I was worth it. And I celebrate those things, and I don't care what you think. The world will be changed by things like that. They want living water. They want their God-shaped hole filled up. And it's our mission to be that. If you've been filling something up in your God-shaped hole that's not God, tonight would you fill it up with the right thing? Would you do what God wants you to do? He made that God-shaped hole. And he knows what's going to fill it. You cram whatever you want in there, but it's not going to fill it right. Would you fill it with the thing that God wants you to fill? You see, when Jesus got across to this woman, she went through the whole town. There's a man. They told me about all my failures and my shortcomings. No, that's not what she said. She said, I found a man that told me everything about me. He knows me, and he loves me, and he talked to me, and that Jew shouldn't have talked to me, but he did. And he stopped, and he gave me something. You too can run through the town letting people know that God gave you something. You can be sharing. You can be walking in a barbershop or a salon. When you leave, you can leave somebody changed, encouraged, lifted up, drawn closer to Christ, or maybe even saved. You have the ability to change people. If you've got God in you, if you've got Jesus in your heart, you've got the ability to make a change. Would you do that tonight? Would you come to the altar, have a time with God, and say, Lord, I'm gonna fill my puzzle piece with the right stuff. I'm not walking through town anymore and leaving it the way I found it. I'm gonna have some change when I walk through. I'm not going in a group of people, but because of what you've done for me, you made something beautiful of my life. You've done something for me and I'm going to change.